It's a great pleasure to be here, and I really hope everyone in this audience gets as excited about routine health data as I do. And if you don't, I hope you'll be a little bit more excited about it another two minutes and 50 seconds time. I'm all the things that are on that thing. I'm also a general practitioner. I describe myself as a senior academic GP. And on the 1st of February, I'll have been 31 years in a practice that's about 500 metres that way, but don't go that way because there's a railway line and the A3 in the way. What I'm going to talk to you about is type 3C diabetes, and I can see the sense of excitement about this. And what we have demonstrated from routine data is there's a lot more of it about, and it has a completely different clinical pattern. And the paper we wrote about this appeared in this very distinguished journal called Diabetes Care. And for those of you who follow along with your social media Medscape, this is the third most paper read by American endocrinologists through the last end of last year. I'm going to start with a little bit of revision about diabetes because everyone's looking a bit blank. So 10% of people with diabetes have what we call type 1 diabetes. If you have type 1 diabetes, you get it often at a young age. Your pancreas completely packs up and you need insulin to survive. You need insulin for life. What's of much more importance from the societal point of view is type 2 diabetes. And as we become less active and more obese, more of us men than ladies get this thing called type 2 diabetes. And if you have type 2 diabetes in this country, about 5% of people go on to require insulin. Most people can be managed with diet and exercise. But the excitement is there's a third sort called type 3C diabetes, and this follows damage to the pancreas. And no one had particularly written this up, and this investigation came out of our own clinical observations that such people might be important. So we have type 2 diabetes predominantly in people who are obese and male and have the wrong diet. And within 5 years, about 4% go on to have diabetes. But if you've had acute pancreatitis, this rises to about 20%. And if you've had chronic pancreatitis, it rises to about 45%, just under half the people. You might say, well, so what? But if you start the course of treatment of type 2 diabetes and you know someone has had pancreatitis, particularly chronic pancreatitis, you can save them from the start. It's about a 50% chance you will end up on insulin. And you can understand and predict the intensification of treatment that might be required. And there hadn't actually been a study prior to this on any sizable population about this problem. So there are more new cases of this type of diabetes than there are of type 1 diabetes. That's the sort of diabetes young people get and require insulin. About 88% of the people who've got this condition are misclassified. Even the Sun reported that I said this. And people with type 3 diabetes are more likely to require insulin. Last thing to say, this research was carried out, I've even written some more distinguished things, but often with collaborations from elsewhere. But I'm very particularly proud of this paper because this is an all Surrey team paper. It's written entirely by people from Surrey, either the university or our collaborators in the hospital. We thought of the idea, we had the data. The other ingredient was I brought here in, March 2015, the Royal College of GPs Research and Surveillance Centre, which is the principal national surveillance system for influenza. But as you're going to use social media, I can't tell you the report. It's going to be released into the public domain at 2 o'clock tomorrow. But if you are interested in what's going on flu and that data set, it's a phenomenal resource for us for the future. So thank you very much.